Hello and welcome to everybody who's joined. My name is Jacqueline Bhabha and I am a faculty member of the Harvard Chan School and the Director of Research at the FXB Center for Health and Human Rights. And I'm delighted to welcome you to our first work in progress seminar this academic year. These are meetings where people present ongoing work and really the opportunities for exchange of ideas and discussion rather than the presentation of already finished and completed studies. So it's a great opportunity for collegial discussion. And so I would invite you to listen to the presentation for about the next 20 or 25 minutes, and then we will keep a nice chunk of time, the second half of this hour, for Q&A. We are recording the first part of the seminar, and then we will turn off the recording when we start the Q&A, so people just for people to know. So I am absolutely delighted to introduce our speaker today, who for many audiences is actually really does not need much of an introduction. Professor Sergio Aguayo is a leading public intellectual in Mexico and beyond. He is an extremely prolific scholar and writer. He publishes voluminously, both in academic context, but also increasingly in newspapers. He comments on particularly Mexican events on a regular basis in Mexico, in print media and on the radio. And he's very well known for his in-depth studies of violence, different types of violence. And I think, you know, I first encountered his work really in the 80s, I think, when he worked with other people, other scholars, an international group of scholars talking about violence as it impinged on forced migrants. But since then, he's gone on to work on many different types of political and criminal violence and the complex factors that impinge on those types of behavior. So he got his PhD from Johns Hopkins, and he is a member of the Colegio de Mexico, which is kind of most prestigious research entity in Mexico City. And for our great fortune, he's been a visiting scientist at the FXB Center now for several years. He first came here as a visiting professor under the auspices of the David Rockefeller Center for Latin American Studies. And we then kind of managed to nab him. And so he comes regularly, periodically every year, and spends some time doing research and engaging with us. So he's working on a new book entitled Mafias and Cartels, The History of Organized Crime in the United States and Mexico from 1920 to 2020. And so today he's going to talk to us about one aspect, I suppose, of that book. And as you can see, the title of his talk is Battle for Mexico City. So Sergio, thank you so much again for joining us, for giving this talk. And let me hand the virtual mic over to you.
Thank you, Jackie. It's always a pleasure to be at FXB. And yes, I arrived in 2014, that is 7 years ago. And the course I taught at Harvard School of Public Health at the time was violence in the Caribbean Basin, something like that. And the argument I made then was that violence is a regional phenomenon and that there are many cleavages and links between the different countries, the 27 countries that are part of the Caribbean Basin. My understanding of criminal violence has evolved over time. I am about in the process of finishing the first volume of a book about one century organized crime in Mexico City, in which I prove the many links there are between Mexico and the US and that we cannot tackle with the challenges presented by organized crime unless we take a regional perspective, a binational perspective. I will make the argument, and I could have devoted my this presentation this week on that book, but I'd rather introduce a project that started 10 days ago on October 1st, and which is to try to replicate the successful experiences of Chicago, Sicily, and some Mexican cities containing organized crime. And that's, we are going to apply for the first time in a huge capital, Mexico City, 9 million inhabitants. And I'm going to talk about the challenges, the intellectual, political challenges presented by the attempt to reproduce what was spontaneously generated in Chicago in the 20s and Sicily in the late 20th century, early 21st century, and some cities, northern cities and Mexico City. Please, Claire, the first, well, shall I move it or not? Okay. There are, continue, please. The first case is Chicago, Al Capone. When I saw the film about Brian De Palma, 80s, I was struck by the simplicity of the argument. I mean, I know Hollywood has to be very simple, but it was not logical that it was a matter of one gangster, Al Capone, and one police, Elliot Ness. It was more complex than that. And when I studied it, and I devoted a lot of time to the study of Chicago, I found that as a matter of fact, the untouchable syndrome left out the actions of organized society. And that some actors in Chicago made possible the prosecution and trial of Al Capone. We know the story, I'm not going to repeat that. Then the following, please. I found the same pattern in, by the way, in New York. I'm not going to talk about New York, it will take me a lot of time. Sicily, a maxi proceso in the 1980s. That was extremely important in the beheading of the Cosa Nostra in Sicily. And again, the same actors, the same social actors appear for the following. Then, and that's a book I wrote about the city in a state that borders the US, Coahuila, in which the state and society launched a very effective offensive to dismantle the Zeta cartel. The Zetas were a very dangerous and murderous criminal organization, and so, and again, the same six actors. Following one, the same, the six social actors and are the groups of victims, entrepreneurs, big entrepreneurs, not just minor ones, public and private universities, NGOs, religious groups, and media. The order of importance is depends on the city. In Chicago, the private sector was fundamental with media. Those two actors were the most important, but also universities. The University of Chicago produced the first serious studies about organized crime in Chicago that I think are still useful, but nevertheless. The question was following, if it could be reproduced elsewhere, because what we found, what I found in Chicago, Sicily, and La Laguna, Torreón, was that it was spontaneously produced. Although the same actors appear, they didn't follow a strategy, but accidental, well, not accidentally, I mean, they were searching for answers, and therefore they coincided, and they went with the president or the governor or whatever to ask, to request for specific policies. the policies that had to do with the knowledge, and knowledge had to do with media and universities. So all the six actors have different roles in the process. And that's what leads me to the project that we just started, and I am very excited about, because it is a major challenge, and it has taken 3 years in the making. El Colegio de México, I belong to the Colegio de México, received an invitation from the government of Mexico City to coordinate a task force on violence in Mexico City. I am the coordinator from El Colegio, and I am the coordinator of the whole effort. That is includes 13 institutions, private and social and academic. Next. Next. The history of organized crime in Mexico is fascinating. I don't have the time, but let me tell you that there was, from 1920 to 1984, there was an understanding, 85, that organized crime activities were going to be left outside, in the north, in the cities, not in Mexico City. Mexico City was left out as part of their understanding. It was never a formal agreement, but there was an understanding between the organized crime and the federal government. So Mexico City was left out for 64 years. Next. Until a journalist was murdered, Manuel Buendia. In 1984, he was executed because he was about to publish a very damaging report about the complicity of federal authorities with drug lords that had the ranch of El Bufalo. I don't think you know about that ranch, but it was huge. About 10,000 people worked there. They the Mexican authorities seized about 5,000 tons of marijuana. I mean, the highest, the biggest, the most important seizure of marijuana that in the history of the hemisphere. Well, he was assassinated. Next. The following year, and out of that assassination, I mean, and of the history of the ranch El Bufalo, a DEA agent was assassinated, executed in Guadalajara, Kiki Camarena. And then it was discovered that behind all this was, next. It is not the picture, but nevertheless, it's the head of the political police, the Directorate of Federal Security. So after that moment, Mexico City became a city to be occupied by the members of the different cartels. And Mexico has a number of cartels. At this moment, there are two very important ones, but there are also another 480 cartels of different sizes all over the country. So the question that we put was, if we are going to replicate the success of Chicago, Sicily, and La Laguna, what is the best place? Mexico, the metropolitan area of Mexico City is 22 million inhabitants, 800,000. I mean, it's huge. This is the map that shows you. And then following, Mexico City, 9 million inhabitants. It is a country. It's the parallel of a country. Next. Mexico City is a very peculiar city because it has highest concentration of security forces. You have the police, 40,000 people. There is another force that is not presented here, another 40,000. So you have about 80,000 in a centralized command. So you have the capacity to react. Then you have the headquarters of the military force and of the National Guard. So you have a huge concentration of military, of security forces. And yet the cartels have the most important cartels operate in Mexico City. Next. From 2012 to 2018, the mayor of Mexico City, Miguel Ángel Mancera, that came to Harvard, by the way, Dr. Class of the School of Design, I mean, to make a presentation about what they were doing, but basically he negated the presence of organized crime, which was stupid things to do because cartels are in Mexico City. All cartels, because it is the most important market for consumers. And at the same time, it is very important because the international airport is one of the port of entrances for the cocaine that comes from South America. Next. Claudia Sheinbaum is the new head of Mexico City. And we reach El Colegio de Mexico, and we reached an agreement to work with the authorities of Mexico City to devise a strategy to tackle with the problem that we have of cartels. Next. The government of Mexico City has been very successful in reducing violence and crime in Mexico City. There is a reduction of 44.6% of the most important criminal activities, criminal assassinations, kidnappings, extortion, and so on. But they have not been able to control cartels because crimes are not only committed by cartels, but also by common criminals. I mean, the ones that want to thieves and whatever. Next. I mentioned the Cartel Jalisco Nueva Generación or Jalisco New Generation Cartel, which is one of the most important in Mexico City and perhaps the most violent. This is a map of a private organization, Lantia, that shows the presence of the cartel all over Mexico, with the exception of Sinaloa. Sinaloa is the white part that's the headquarters of the cartel de Sinaloa, the Sinaloa cartel, that has also presence all over Mexico. So if you want, there are two major cartels, Sinaloa and Jalisco. Those are the two most important. And the most violent is Jalisco. Sinaloa has another policy in the use of violence. Next. This is a map of the different sections of Mexico City. And you can see the five most important cartels that are present in Mexico. They are local groups that are affiliated with Jalisco or Sinaloa, or are independent. I mean, they operate in a constant shifting of alliances among them. But they are present in every county, because Mexico City is divided in sort of municipalities, some of them very big, some very small, some more important than others. We are studying a few of them. Next. In June 2020, the head of Mexico City security, the head of the police, was attacked by a group of special forces from Jalisco Nueva Generación of 27 people. 27 people at 5:30 in the morning of that day in the most wealthy neighborhood of Mexico City intercepted the vehicle of the head of Mexico City police. And they launched an attack that included the use of five barrets and all sorts of weapons. the two bodyguards of Omar Garcia, the head of the police, were killed. He was wounded three times, but he survived somehow. So it is obvious that at the same time that Mexico City has a major security force, at the same time, they have the presence of cartels that are capable of organizing a major paramilitary operation without the presence or the capacity of Mexican intelligence to anticipate the attack. That's a symptom of the power that cartels have in not only in Mexico, but in the capital. Next. Next. It is at this moment that we started the project, but we created a consortium that is headed by El Colegio de México of six institutions that are, I cannot give the names because we are not public yet. We are going to appear in a few weeks, but there are six institutions that have an expertise on violence in Mexico City that know some neighborhoods and understand the cartels and have the confidence or the relation with Mexico City authorities. We are already negotiating or talking with Mexican authorities. What are we planning to do? To replicate the success of Chicago, Sicily, and La Laguna, the question is, how do we replicate something that was spontaneous? So intellectually, we had to divide the process in different ingredients, in different elements, and I'm going to mention them just to show you, perhaps next year, I can give you an update how we are moving, how we are advancing. But so far we have the funds. We hire already a top person as a consultant that works in the first stages. Next. We are going to work with the same social actors, six social actors that we found in Chicago, Sicily, and La Laguna. Exactly the same. Next. There is one peculiarity of Mexico as a country, the high decentralization of knowledge, economic power, political power in Mexico City. So Mexico City has a system of national researchers. I am a national researcher, level 3, which is the highest. And there are 35,000 national researchers. And we are giving a monthly stipend, because what the country or the government wants is that we produce knowledge. So that we are giving different kind of support to make that possible. Well, 26% of the national researchers are in Mexico City, which is, it gives you an idea of the concentration. Next. NGOs, I think I have the figure here, is about 20%. Yes, 21% of all NGOs in Mexico City are in Mexico City. The concentration is, 9,000, almost 10,000. And you take Nuevo León, which is very important, the most important economic, it has Monterrey, the most important economic capital of the country, 1,000. So we have 8 times more national researchers. Next. Newspapers, magazines, books, radio and television. We have 460, the headquarters of the most important newspapers and radio and television channel are in Mexico City. Next. 1,644 religious organizations are based in Mexico City. From another perspective, we have a problem of excessive concentration of power, knowledge, information in Mexico City to the detriment of other cities and states. Next. Now, what we are doing now is selecting the strategic partners in each one of the six groups. Because the six organizations that are part of the consortium are, we trust each other. We have known for many years, so we know that we are serious people. I mean, that we are not infiltrated, that we can control information, that we are responsible with sensitive information. So we are now in the process of selecting strategic partners, which two or three people or organizations or churches or newspapers are going to be our counterparts. Second, next. We are already preparing a minimum agenda. We know that the crime is going down in Mexico City because we have the figures. The question is what society wants? And that because the local government is launching policies according to what they believe is what is best for society, but society has to have a saying. So we are preparing an agenda that we can negotiate with our strategic partners. At this moment, we are working to say, well, what is the importance of women's security? Because we have a problem of homicides of women. 12 women are assassinated every day in Mexico. Not in Mexico City, in Mexico, but Mexico City and the metropolitan area of Mexico City, the 22 million inhabitants, is a major problem. So we must decide what is the importance we are going to give to extortion, because cartels go to the business people and charge taxes to tax people, tax organizations. So is that the priority? We want to select five issues that we consider are the most important. Next. Then we will go with the authorities. We have already a working relation with them to say the consortium and its allies in private sectors, media, churches, NGOs, universities, and victims, we want this for 2022-2023. That part is going to be difficult because, of course, one major problem is we have with the police, the corruption of the police. So are they going to accept that there are new types of control that are supervised by the consortium and its allies? I don't know what's going to happen, but that's the idea. That comes next year. I mean, in January, we'll start the talks with authorities. Next. Then it will come, as I told you, when the authorities accept three out of our five priorities, or two. Then we'll follow up, we monitor to be able to make sure that they are following our instructions or our recommendations. However you want to put it, we want to have an influence, have a say in public policy on security. Next. Well, that's all. And simultaneously, we already have requests from other governments of other cities that want to be incorporated in the project, in this project. I don't know if we will do that because we want to make sure that Mexico City is working, but some cities in the north are interested in finding out more about how they can control organized crime. The three cases I mentioned, Chicago, Sicily, and La Laguna, are important because they are sustainable. They have been able to control organized crime, not eliminate, to to contain and control, to keep it in certain level. I mean, we don't have as a goal the eradication, the total eradication of organized crime. That I don't think is feasible or logical. International crime is one of the new actors of international actors in the world. So, I mean, we don't pretend that we have the capacity to do that. I mean, that requires a joint agenda, for example, of Mexico and the US and Central America and Colombia and Venezuela. And that's not a logical goal, I mean, to have at this moment. So that's, I mean, intellectually, I am very involved, as I told you at the beginning, in finishing the book, in understanding the history of organized crime in the US, Mexico, and the interaction between the two countries at different levels. But simultaneously, I am very excited because out of that research came a possible solution. I don't want to be over optimistic because I don't know. I mean, I don't know if it's going to happen, but what I know is that there is a cure that has been proved in three major cities or regions, because Sicily is not a city. I mean, although Palermo has been a success in many ways, but and see if we can implement and advance and make it a fact of life that Mexico City has a different policy. And if we succeed, then I think we are going to put a major step in proving that knowledge, applied knowledge, can be a solution to the to major mankind problems, in this case, organized crime in a major country that is Mexico. It's a neighbor of the US. And just to give you the size of Mexico, so you can get an idea, so we are two-thirds the size of India. I like to say this because that gives you an idea of the dimension, the physical dimension of the countries. And we are only 130 million inhabitants, I mean, not like India, that is much larger in terms of population. But if we can make it in Mexico City, I think we can make it everywhere, following the song of New York.